Numbers. Human life cannot be imagined without numbers. How did the humans learn to count? And where did the numbers and their symbols come from?
Numbers always, in the civilizational sense that we are talking about, came from everyday activities. How many people are there, what work they would do, if there is an exchange, how many chickens you will exchange, say, for how many boxes of grains. So the first simplest would have been just one number is all you need. And then one mark, two mark, three marks. This is how the number system would have started in different languages or alphabets that we have.
Counting systems have been known from, first of all, of course, the Babylonians, Egyptians, then there another time from Mayan system, Mayans, Chinese, and of course from India.
Different civilizations came up with different ways of recording higher numbers. For instance, the Greek, Hebrew, and Egyptian numerals were extensions of tally marks with new symbols added to represent larger magnitudes.
If you can see, for instance, even today in what we call the Roman numerals, 1, 2, 3 are repetitions of just increasing the number of marks that we have. Then when you go to 4, you start using actually 5 and 1 in a subtractive sense, if you will, by putting it on the left. So you start then 6, again you start repeating. Then when it comes to 9, it's really 10 minus 1. That's how we would see the number.
What we call the Roman numbers, which are still used in some clocks and some things. So with those, it is not so easy to do calculations. This has to do with the fact that they were not using the way of writing for calculations. The calculations were actually done using the abacus, our abacus-like device. And it's only the recording that involved the representation.
You want to compute, for instance, how much of grains are being produced. So you have to have a way to measure how much the land will produce, and you have to have a measure of how much a total land area that is being cultivated by, say, a landowner. Why is that important? Because you already have a concept of taxation. The kings, the temples levied taxes. And when they levied taxes, they did not really know how much you're going to produce, but they would levy taxes based on what is the land you have and how much you've produced. Therefore, a percentage of your product would then be levied as tax. And using those symbols, adding, subtracting, well, still possible. When it comes to multiplying and dividing, which we will have to do if you're talking about, say, taxes, you're talking about, for instance, areas, it becomes increasingly more and more difficult.
To write and calculate larger numbers, some civilizations came up with a more useful system known today as the positional notation or the place value notation.
Conceptualizing separately the hundreds, the tens and one units, and then composing the number. This is what is called the positional number system. This is the decimal positional system.
So let us understand our own decimal system. Take, for example, the number 231. Here, the number 1 is in the units place. The number 3 is in the tens place. And the number 2 is in the hundreds place. What does it mean by hundreds, tens, and units? What it means is that we multiply 2 by 100, we add 3 multiply by 10, that we put in parenthesis, and we add 1 multiplied by 1. This is the same as 2 into 10 square plus 3 into 10 to the power 1 plus 1 multiplied by 10 to the power 0, because 10 to the power 0 is 1. So this is the decimal system. The decimal becomes important because here, as you see, there's all 10, 10, and 10.
And in certain other cultures, the system has been different. The Mayans had basically a system based on base 20. The Chinese, on the other hand, had a system which is based on 10 as the base. So something very similar to what we did, what we had, except that there was no position allotted to zero. A similar thing happened also in the Babylonians.
The Babylonians didn't have the decimal number system. They had a sexagesimal number system. And just like in decimal number system, we have the 9 digits 1 through 9 plus 0. And so we write 11 as 1, 1, that's 10 plus 1. They had 60 digits in the, and that's a sexagesimal system. However, they had a very nice way, a very clever way, instead of remembering 60 digits, they have a very clever way of using 12 as a base to create the other numbers in the first 60 digits.
60 gets divided by many more numbers, so arithmetic is relatively easier with a base 60. But the disadvantage is 60 is a large number. You know, it's not a small number, it still is there, for instance, in minutes, hours, seconds, which is still on a sexagesimal basis. The remnant of the Babylonian system is still there in our use, but we don't use it as a number base anymore. And the number base, it becomes more convenient if you have something called 10 as a number base. Of course, it originates from a 5 plus 5, 10 fingers.
In India, people talked of numbers already from the Vedic period in powers of 10. So they had names for 10, Ekadasha, Shata, Sahasra, etc. Early times it went up to 10 is to 12, and then there was 10 is to 17. And in Buddhist tradition, there was even much larger numbers. 54 of that order.
But the Jains actually went far beyond that, because they were trying to reach, shall we say, infinity in some way. And trying to reach infinity, their method was to construct very large numbers and say, actually the universe is bigger than even this. So that's where it originates from. The quest is really a cosmological one. And for that cosmological quest for large numbers, they need to express or show how large numbers can be written.
Now, as regards the concrete decimal representation of numbers, there are records, the epigraphic record, that's in terms of writing on stone, that comes only from the 9th century. But there are some earlier records, again there are some disputes about them. In the study of ancient Indian mathematics, there is considerable degree of uncertainty about various sources and so on. So in a way, not much is written on stone, as one would say. Though the systems were evolving through different various cultures, but this came to be practiced actually both in India and in China. The decimal system was being used, and the Arabs, this went to Arabs. I mean, I should mention that Brahmagupta was the one who in fact systematically wrote about how this arithmetic works, and some of these manuscripts made their way to the Arab and Persian lands. And they imbibed them, and they in fact developed them further. Then it spread to the West from there. The Arabs sort of through Arab to through Spain and then to Italy. And in the 13th, 14th century, this arithmetic from Indo-Arabic arithmetic was in fact a big thing in Italy. Because the trade was expanding, and in fact, I mean, this was still not a part of the curricular education either in school or college, but the people used to pay fair amounts to get a tutor who would teach their wards the arithmetic in the style that we do today.
In the first instance, when you repeat the number again from 11 to 19, the 10 was not represented by two digits. In fact, it starts in Babylon again, where the place value notation originates from. It started by leaving a gap over there. Okay, so there was a place for a number, but it was left blank, indicating there was no number. So the problem comes up is what happens if what we understand as zero, or the absence of a number, is at the end of it. Now that space becomes very difficult to understand, that there is a blank after this. And if it is in the middle of two numbers, well, you can approximate absence of a number. There is no concept of zero in such a system, and that's why in our, if you see what used to be called the AD-BC way of counting years, there was no zero year. Okay, there is one AD, there is one BC, but there is no zero year because there is no concept of an absence of a year as such. So this problem arises with the place value notation when you try to write it. And then they decided that first let's indicate some marker to indicate there is something here, but it actually has no value.
A symbol for the concept of nothing. I mean, why do you need to count nothing? But this really kick-started some extraordinary mathematics, things like the calculus. Even our digital age is dependent on things like ones and zeros. Well, amazingly, mathematics was really vibrant in the Indian subcontinent, and we find zero being talked about for the first time there.
From, say, about 5th century BC to about 5th century AD, the most active mathematically seemed to be the Jain monks or the Jains who did a lot of these inquiries and also talked about it and wrote it down. They start talking about the place value which is left empty as shunya, and that's sort of the origin of even the word sifra, then it becomes zero. So all this cipher, zero, a lot of these things originate from really in different ways, etymologically from the void as the concept.
Although the earliest use of zero has been recorded in several historical locations in South Asia, the oldest so far is a series of birch bark manuscripts discovered in 1881 at the Bakshali village in Khyber area of the present-day Pakistan.
It is the oldest representation of zero, the modern symbol of zero, shall we say, anywhere else. But here it must be understood. When you look at the Bakshali manuscripts and what is the mathematics that is there, the 3rd century, what have been dated in the 3rd century text, or we still haven't dated all the pages of the Bakshali manuscripts, only a sample of them, they seem to indicate that in this phase, the 3rd century phase, because Bakshali manuscripts is a combination of texts from different centuries, the 3rd century text, it seems it was used basically as a symbol. The rules of arithmetic were not applied to the symbol zero.
The Bakshali manuscript is actually quite a complicated document because it isn't just one piece of mathematics, it's many pieces written over, it appears now, quite a few centuries. And it seems to be a document helping merchants to do mathematical calculations. So there are lots of examples and lots of numbers. And this is where we see the zero, because in some of these numbers we see a dot. This is a dot saying there is nothing here. And so this dot is the one that will eventually open up to be the zero that we use today. The idea of zero as a placeholder is actually very ancient. The ancient Babylonians, the Mayans had an idea of a zero as a placeholder. So something like 101 means there are no tens. So we see zero in the Bakshali manuscript being used as a placeholder. But why is this so important as a moment in the history of mathematics? Because this symbol eventually gives rise to zero in its own right, a number for counting absolutely nothing. And this is a revolutionary moment in mathematics.
These could be applied to operations with zero. It's clearly enunciated first really in India. It seems that Aryabhatta may have been aware of it, but clear enunciation of the rules of arithmetic of the sense is really with Brahmagupta. Brahmagupta, Bhaskara, Varahamihir, all these now are getting into enunciating the rules of arithmetic with zero as the number. So this is something which happens between 5th and 7th century.
Zero gave us access to the negative numbers. How? Because just like we can say that, okay, 5 minus 3 is 2, but you could not say what is 3 minus 5. Now from 3 minus 5 you can go to a minus 2, you can go to the left of the line. So if you think of the line with 1 starting here, 2 here, 3 here, 4 here, etc., what you have done is you've just added 1 to the left of it and called it 0. Minus 1 is the number minus 1. Just go beyond.
Negative numbers were considered valid in a lot of the Indian works, but somehow in Europe there was a lot of resistance or lack of willingness to admit negative numbers.
If you are doing borrowing and lending, if you are in trade, how much have you borrowed, how much have you given back? The Chinese, for instance, had red and black sticks for negative and positive numbers. But it was mathematically very difficult for them to think about taking out something bigger than something that existed.
As late as 20th century, people wrote papers or articles saying that negative numbers did not make sense. I mean, it sounds like people believing flat earth, etc. But as late as 20th century, there are European writers reluctant to think of negative numbers. But on the other hand, in India, negative numbers are found from very old times.
We talked about the evolution of numbers, the place value notation, and the use of zero besides the negative numbers. The story of Ganita or mathematics cannot be completed without exploring the developments in geometry and proof system. That is something we will discuss in the next part of our film. One of the oldest and widespread mathematical developments after the basic arithmetic and geometry was a theorem named after Pythagoras, a Greek mathematician from the 6th century BC.
The Pythagoras theorem is something which all of you learned even in class 5. It says that if you take a right angle triangle with C being the hypotenuse and A and B the two other sides, then A squared plus B squared equals C squared. So suppose, think of yourselves as 10-year-olds. You want to play football, you want to mark a field. Okay. So this is a typical football field, the goal boxes, the line in the middle, the central line, and the field. Suppose you have just a long rope and you want to do this. So what you do is you take the rope and you tie knots to divide it into 12 equal pieces. Once you've done that, then you take three of your friends, tell one of them to be on the third knot, another one in the fourth knot after that, and the other one on the end who holds the two ends together. What you have now is a right angle triangle, because one of the sides is 3, the other is 4, hypotenuse is 5, right? So 3 square plus 4 square equals 5 square. So you've been able to draw a right angle. The first known evidence of Pythagorean theorem actually comes from Babylonia. The Babylonian civilization succeeded the Sumerian civilization, and the Sumerians actually their civilization was quite advanced. They had an administrative and legal systems. They built irrigational canals. They introduced writing using a cuneiform script. Cuneiform means corners. They made clay, and on clay with a reed marker, you know, they marked things, and then they baked it. Okay, and that's why in the Babylonian and Mesopotamian tablets still survive, and we know so much about them now. So this is a typical clay tablet which exhibit lots of geometric pictures, and there were various such things found. So in one such tablet, which is again in the British Museum, there is a nice problem that 4 is the length, 5 is the diagonal, what is the breadth? Its size is not known. And they had also given an answer to it in the same tablet. 4 times 4 is 16, 5 times 5 is 25. You take 16 from 25, there remains 9. What times what is 9? 3 times 3 is 9, so 3 is the breadth.
There is also another Babylonian tablet, the cuneiform tablet, which in which there is a shows a computation of square root of 2 in represented in the success decimal system which they were following, and that certainly involves the Pythagoras theorem. I mean, to understand the magnitude, one had to know the Pythagoras theorem.
There are marks on the side on the left and 2 on the horizontal diagonal of the square. So there are 2 marks on the horizontal diagonal and 1 mark there. What are they? They are the numbers 30, then 1, 24, 51, 10, 42, 25, 35. This is the sexagesimal system. So 30 is exactly like 5 in a decimal system. And what we can think of 5 as being half of 10. So if you translate this, and if you remember that 30 is half of 60, What's the red line is just half, and below there are two things. One is the sixth decimal approximation of square root 2, with this approximation divided by 2. If you do an elementary Pythagoras, so the red line is half, the other line to its left is also of length half. Half square plus half square, then the square root of that becomes root 2 by 2.
It's well known that the Babylonians had the table of Pythagorean triples. Now, some people have debated that may not exactly correspond to Pythagorean theorem, but on the other hand, could be.
It's called Plimpton 322. This is just a list of Pythagorean triplets. A 3, 4, 5 is called the Pythagorean triplet because 3 square plus 4 square equals 5 square. And these were probably used in practical applications in land measurements and various other things, in irrigation canals. So the Chinese civilization is the only civilization which has been uninterrupted. So we know a lot about it because of the continuity. Around 2700 before the Christian era, there's this Chinese emperor, Huang Ti, who took an active interest in mathematics. And he's supposed to have composed a text. But of course, that's lost now. But these are on astronomy and mathematics. Chinese call this theorem the Go-Gu theorem. Go is the hypotenuse and Gu is the side. So one of the pictures from the book relates to two proofs of the Pythagoras theorem. So remember, till now, the Mesopotamia and everything, there was no mention of a proof. Here they do a mathematical proof in the modern day sense. And one very interesting problem which they have in this book is called the bent bamboo problem. You can see how global mathematics is from here. The bent bamboo problem, which they say, is that there's a bamboo which is 10 chi. Chi is the unit of length in China. The upper end of which, being broken, touches the ground. So it was a rod like this. It broke here, and so it has become a triangle now. And it says it touches the ground 3 chi from the foot of the stem. They ask, what is the height of the break? So you know it was 10 chi, it broke. So what is this height now? So of course you have a right angle triangle. You know that the hypotenuse plus this height is 10. You know this length is 3. You can set up the equation. A plus C, if C is the hypotenuse, A plus C is 10, the base is 3, so that these are the two equations you get. And you also have the equation from the Pythagoras theorem, A square plus B square equals C square. So you can solve this quadratic equation and you get the answer A equals 91 by 20. It appears exactly same in Mahavira's Ganita Shastra, which was around 850 Christian era. And later in Europe via Arabs, in this Filippi Calandri's book called Arithmetic from 1491.
Earliest explicitly stated statement of the theorem comes from the Shulva Sutras, especially Bodhana being the earliest from among the Shulva Sutras.
Shulva Sutras are part of the Vedanga Kalpa Sutras of the Vedas, and Vedangas are the so-called appendices of the Vedas. There are 9 Shulva Sutras, of which 3 ascribe to Bodhana, Agastamba and Katyayana, the Vedangas which are rich in mathematics.
The Shulva Sutras specify the construction of Yajna Bhumika, or fire altars. Very elaborate structures were described in verse, but without diagrams. The most famous of these is the falcon altar, which comprises of certain geometrical shapes like parallelograms, rectangles, triangles, and various other types. The Shulva Sutras are very specific about these sizes so that the brick makers could bake the exact shapes.
There is this Sanskrit sloka there, which basically translates to the chord placed along the diagonal of a square produces an area double the size of the square. If I see this diagram, AC square is double the size of the area of the square inside. The square inside is of length AB times BC, but AB and BC are the same. 2AB times BC is 2AB squared, which is the same as AB squared plus BC squared, which is exactly the Pythagoras theorem for a square. They also talk about a rectangle. Here they say that the chord placed along the diagonal of a rectangle produces both the areas which the chords along the longer and the shorter sides produce. It's exactly the same thing.
The main objectives of the Shulva Sutras was to convey how this structure, elaborate structure, is to be constructed. And there are stipulations of various kinds. First of all, it had to be in 5 layers of bricks. Each layer was made up of 200 tiles. They could be of different shapes. They could be square, triangle, and then sometimes even pentagonal and so on.
For brick building purposes, the sutras had to be more specific. So as in the Plimpton 322 tablet, where there was this list of numbers, in the Vedas also, in Bodhyana Sutra, there are lists also given. So they write 3 and 4, the 5 will come, 12 and 5, 15 and 8. These are all part of Pythagorean triplets.
In the process of doing this kind of work, they realized various geometric principles. One of the fundamental things in basic geometry is to be able to draw a perpendicular. Given one line and a point on that, you need to draw a perpendicular. This is one of the first things that one learns in school, right? And the method that we use in the school, that's taught in the schools, was in fact known at the time of Shilva Sutras.
You know, the Pythagorean triplets, because they're so basic, probably originated in each of these three places independently. There's no reason to believe that there was a monogenetic origin for Pythagoras' theorem. Unfortunately, we do not know much about the Egyptian civilization in the sense that we don't have evidence of Pythagorean triplets, but I'm pretty sure that they would have had it, because if they could build such elaborate pyramids and everything, I'm sure they had it. If we could also get evidence from the civilizations in America, because they were completely disjoint. Unfortunately, again, we don't have much evidence, but there also they built pyramids. The Mayans, the Incas had this terrace farming and everything.
So these are local variations, but I would say that each of them are true in their own right, that yes, these are the areas which reached this conclusion, and it is neither that the Greeks, we gave the world the Pythagoras theorem, and it is also an appropriation of the West to claim it is a Pythagoras theorem. It actually belongs to nature, not to Pythagoras. The Greeks, as I said, because they had geometricized their mathematics much more than others, therefore they also were the first to establish a formal way of writing down geometry.
When you go for statement for statements, especially in geometry, which are a little more complicated, if somebody makes them, there are two things. Firstly, there is some way in which they would have arrived at it, and secondly, that having arrived it, they would have some way of confirming or validation. I would call validation. So, proof has. The main component in proof is validation.
And if you look at what proof we were taught about the Pythagoras theorem, it's essentially a visual proof. You move certain squares around and you fit it in from one set of squares to another set of squares, and you see, okay, you know, they really fit in. And therefore, visually a proof, therefore, that the squares of the two sides are equal to the square of the hypotenuse.
A mathematician will not accept a statement if it is not accompanied by a proof.
The complete idea of proof, as evolved from the Greek tradition, is that you should be able to give a proof which is sort of independent of whom you are trying to convince, including an adversarial participant of this debate. You cannot go back and back and back to prove. So there are certain things you have to assume, that they're called axioms or postulates, and then you have a certain system of accepted principles of how what implies what, and then you went on from there to deduce statements. So those would be valid statements. If you arrived by intuition at some statement being true, then it was kind of a duty for you to be able to produce an argument which would lead to that.
One such example is the infiniteness of prime numbers. What's a prime number? A prime number is a positive integer which is not divisible by any other positive integer except itself and 1. 3 is a prime, 7 is a prime, but 15 is not, because 15 is divisible by 3 and 5. So a question which is attributed to Euclid, which he asked, is how many prime numbers are there? There are infinitely many prime numbers. There's no limit. So one way of proving is what's called reductio ad absurdum, or proof by contradiction. He says, okay, suppose there is an end to it. Suppose there's an n to the primes, so then there has to be a largest prime. Suppose for argument's sake, 17 is the largest prime. You multiply all the numbers from 1 to 17. Then the product is divisible by 1, 2, 3, all the way up to 17. But you add 1 to it. Now when you divide by anything, there'd always be a remainder of 1. So this number plus 1 is a number which is not divisible by any of the primes. Either it itself is a prime, or there's some other prime number larger than 17 which will divide it. So this is a proof.
So in the Indian tradition, they did go beyond the obvious statements, and then they had means of validating that, but the validation was not based on the systematic procedure, or no systematic procedure was in fact laid down. So in that sense, it is true that Indian mathematics did not have proofs. That does not mean that they simply contemplated and they found every statement. They had means of, they had ways of arriving at statement, they had ways of convincing their counterparts. The word upapatti, there is a word upapatti which means more like explanation or something like that, which played the role of proof in Indian mathematics.
If we give credit to the South Asian cultural area for the number system, place value notation and zero as it is known to the modern world, though each of them might have been discovered in different ways, we have to similarly give credit to the Greeks for having reached this model of proof, which is really a powerful method of proof.
The mathematics is something which is just completely universal. Nobody is shy of taking ideas from elsewhere or contributing to that. Having a geographical ownership of mathematics doesn't make any sense.